Here we're going to talk about simplifying and combining radical expressions. Okay, so first of all, I would like you to recall that if you take a times b and you square the whole thing, do you remember how this works? First, because it's multiplication here, you square a and you square b. So this is equal to a squared b squared, okay? Where a, b are any two numbers. Now, that applies, for example, in this situation. You could take the square root of 2 multiplied by the square root of 3, and you could square that. Now, a is root 2, and b is root 3. So I first get root 2 quantity squared, and then I get root 3 squared. Now, root 2 squared is just root 2 times root 2, which is equal to 2, and then square root of 3 squared is just the square root of 3 times the square root of 3, which is 3. And so 2 times 3 gives me 6. Now on the other hand, notice that if you take the square root of 6 and you square it, well, the square root of 6, this is a 6 right here, the square root of 6 times the square root of 6 is just equal to 6. So notice on the first line, I took this and I squared it and I got 6, right? And then on the second line, I took something else and I squared it and I got 6. Now, because these are both positive and you squared each of them and you got 6, these two quantities must be the same. And here's the point, that the square root of 2 multiplied by the square root of 3 is equal to the square root of 6. Now, the square root of 6, of course, the 6 itself is 2 times 3. And now I'd like you to compare this with that. How are those different? Well, they're different in the sense that you basically, over here, you took the radicands and you multiplied them together, and then you took the radical of that, or the square root of that. So this illustrates what's called the product rule. So this is the product rule for radicals. And what it tells you is that if you have the nth root of a, so the n can be, you know, whatever index you're talking about. It could be 2, like the square root, or 3, the cube root, and so on. So the nth root of a multiplied by the nth root of b, okay? As long as these are the same, right? They're both n's, then you get the nth root of a multiplied by b. So this is a rule we're going to be using in this section, the product rule for radicals. So you just have to make sure that the indices are the same. Let me go ahead and erase this so you can see that there's an n right there. That looked a little ambiguous. So this is an n, the same way that is, okay? So whenever the indices match, you simply keep the common index and you multiply the radicands together. Okay, let's see an example of the product rule in action and how we can make use of it to simplify radical expressions. Okay, let's simplify the square root of 50. Now, 50 is not a perfect square, right? Like, perfect squares would be 4 or 9 or 16 or 25. But what I can do is I can note that 50, I can write 50 as a product where one of the factors is a perfect square. So I can write 50 as 2 times 25. Now you might say, why did I choose that factorization? Why not 5 times 10? The reason is because 25 is a perfect square. And what I can use now is the product rule in the opposite direction. So not only is the square root of a times the square root of b, the square root of ab, it's also true the product rule goes the other way. The square root of ab can also be broken up into the square root of a times the square root of b, okay? So this is the product rule just going the other direction. And with that, I can write this as, because it's multiplication right here, I can write this as the square root of 2 times the square root of 25. And of course, the square root of 25 is 5. So this is the square root of 2 multiplied by 5. Now we usually write this in the following way. Because multiplication is commutative, we usually write this as 5 times the square root of 2. Okay, and that'll be our answer. So this radical expression is considered simplified because no longer do I have a power, a perfect a perfect square under the radical. Okay, let's try another one like that, but now using variables. So when I look at this, the first thing I notice is that the index is 3. So I'm no longer thinking about perfect squares. I'm thinking about perfect cubes. And perfect cubes are like 8, because 8 is 2 cubed, or 27, which is 3 cubed, or 64, which is 4 cubed, and likewise 5 cubed is 125. Okay, so the index guides your thinking about what perfect powers you're looking for. So do you remember over here how I saw 50 as 2 times 25, and 25 was a perfect square? Likewise, can you think of a factorization of 16 that involves one of these perfect cubes? Of course, right? You can see that 16 is 2 times 8. So let's first write that. This is going to become the cube root, and I'm going to write a long radical symbol here. So it's the cube root of, okay, 2 times 8. That's a factorization of 16 involving a perfect cube. And now think about x to the 7th. Now, when you play the perfect power game for exponential expressions, you might think that you need one of these numbers as your exponent. That's not true. And the reason is because all you need is the exponent to be divisible by whatever index you have. So for example, 7 is not divisible by 3, but 6 is. And that's why I'm going to write x to the 7th as x to the 6th times x. So x to the 6th is a perfect power, it's a perfect cube, right? And that's because 6 is divisible by 3. So this is a little tricky. For the exponents, it's an issue of divisibility by the index, right? You don't need that, there is no, you know, when you have coefficients or just numbers, then you're thinking about the numbers themselves being perfect cubes. Exponents, it's only divisibility. Okay, now when I think about the y to the 12th, I already know this is a perfect cube, and the reason is because 12 is divisible by 3, and so I don't have to change that y to the 12th. Okay, now what you can do is, over here, once I had the perfect square, I split them up, right? And I'm going to do the same thing here. So where are my perfect cubes? Well, 8's a perfect cube, x to the 6th, and y to the 12th. So let's break those off to the side. So we have the cube root, it's going to be of 8, x to the 6th, y to the 12th, okay, times the cube root of whatever wasn't a perfect cube, and that was a 2 and an x. Okay, so the little factors that are underlined, those are my perfect cubes, and I put them over here. And now I'm going to say, okay, well, the cube root of 8 is 2, the cube root of x to the 6th is x squared, and then the cube root of y to the 12th is y to the 4th. So because these are all perfect cubes, I'm mentally sort of splitting these up and saying, okay, what's the cube root of 8? It's 2. What's the cube root of x to the 6th? X squared. What's the cube root of y to the 12th? That's y to the 4th. And then you still have this right here, which is the cube root of 2x. Okay, so this would be your answer. 2x squared y to the 4th multiplied by the cube root of 2x. Okay, so that's generally how we use the product rule. Most of the time, the product rule is useful for simplifying a radical by splitting up the radicands into writing the radicand as a product involving either perfect squares or perfect cubes or whatever your index is working with, or whatever your index guides you to. Okay, so just like there is a product rule, there also is a quotient rule. And the quotient rule simply looks like this. Let's write this down. So this is what we're going to call the quotient rule for radicals. Now the word quotient may help you guess that you're talking about division. And so the way that looks is as follows. It's going to be the nth root of a divided by the nth root of b, and as long as they have the same indices, once again, you get a giant radical. So it's going to be the nth root of a divided by b. Okay, so it's just like the product rule, except that you combine the numerator and denominator into one large quotient and then take the nth root of that. Okay, so let's see an example of how we use the quotient rule to simplify. All right, let's say we're asked to simplify. And how about the square root of a to the eighth divided by something, how about 81 b to the 10th? Okay, so when I look at this, the first thing I notice is that I'm actually looking at the, I'm thinking about the quotient rule, but in reverse, right? Because I have one giant radical. And what I can do is I can split this single radical into two radicals. So I can take the square root of the numerator, right? The square root of a to the eighth, and then divide that by the square root of the denominator. That is the square root of 81 b to the 10th. Okay, and then in the numerator, what's the square root of a to the eighth? Well, for the exponents, it's divisible, it's division, right? So it's 8 divided by 2, which is 4. So it's a to the 4th. And in the denominator, let's see, the square root of 81 is 9. But when you talk about the exponent right here, it's division again. So it's 10 divided by 2, which is 5. So it's 9 b to the 5th. Okay, and that would be our answer for this one. Okay, so another application of the product and the quotient rules is that it helps us first simplify and then combine radicals. Okay, so thinking about that, we're going to now talk about what's called combining like radicals. Now, I first want you to think about this phrase, combining like. You've seen those words together before, right? And you've combined like terms in the past. So for example, you know how to combine, let's say you had 3x squared plus 8x minus 12x squared. So what are like terms? Well, like terms are ones where the you have the same variable but with the same exponent as well. So the first and the third term are like terms. And the way you do that is by combining their coefficients. So 3 take away 12 is negative 9x squared, and then plus 8x. Now these two terms are not like, and so this is as far as we can go. Right? So like terms have to have the same variable with the same exponent. Okay, let's take that logic and combine what we call like radicals. So let's combine. Let's say we had 5 times the square root of 2 plus 7 times the square root of 2 minus 15 square root of 3. Okay, so when I look at this, I have to first ask myself, what are like radicals? And the answer is, like radicals have the same index, but also the same radicand. Okay, so let's write that down. We're looking for same index and the same radicand. Okay, so in other words, remember in this example over here, you needed the base to be the same, but you also needed the exponent to be the same, right? These had to be replicas of each other. Same thing here. The square root of 2 and the square root of 2, these have to be exactly the same to be considered like radicals, which they are. Radical 3, or the square root of 3, is not a like radical when compared with these, right? Because even though it has the right index of a 2, the radicand is different, it's a 3. So the question is how do you combine like radicals? The answer is, you act as if like the square root of 2 was an x. So if this was 5x plus 7x, you'd get 12x, right? Same thing here. 5 plus 7 is 12, and then you keep the common, what they have in common, which is the square root of 2. And then you finally have minus 15 root 3. Now you can't go any further because it's like having 12x minus 15y. The fact that the square root of 2 and the square root of 3 are not like means that we can't go any further, right? So these two radicals are not like radicals. Okay, let's take another one like that now, just to make sure we've got it. Okay, so first we want to simplify this expression involving the addition of three radicals, or three radical expressions. Now when I look at this, the first thing I notice is that these are not like radicals. And so you might say to yourself, well, we can't do anything, right? We're stuck. But remember, we know how to simplify radicals. So for example, 20 I can write as 4 times 5. So this is the square root of 4 times 5. And 45 I can write as the square root of 9 times 5. And 32 I can write as the square root of 16 times 2. And then when I simplify these, right, remember, you can split these up. And the square root of 4 is 2. So you're going to get 2 square root of 5. And the next one, you're going to get what? Well, square root of 9 is 3 square root of 5. And then plus, well, it's going to be 4 square root of 2. Now, when I look at these three radicals, yeah, each of them is as simplified as can be. And these two happen to be like radicals because they both have the square root of 5. So the way you combine those is by adding their coefficients. 2 plus 3 is 5, so our answer is 5 square root of 5. But then this radical is not like 4 square root of 2. So this would be as far as we can go with this one. So the point of this problem is that when you want to combine radicals, you have to make sure they're completely simplified. And then sometimes after you've done that, then you can actually combine them. Okay, and the same logic holds if the radicands involve variables. So when I look at these two radicals, I first might think to myself that they're not like. But remember, you can simplify. So I have 3 and x to the 4th, right? That's a perfect square. So when I take the square root of that, I get x squared. And I'm left with the square root of y in the radicand. And then minus 11x squared. And then, well, the square root of 16y, remember, 16, the square root of 16 is 4. And so I have the square root of y. And now, let's see, this one I'll just leave as 3x squared square root of y. But for the next one, I can multiply these together and I get 44x squared. And then I have the square root of y. And then I say to myself, well, these are like radicals, right? They both have the square root of y. And so the way you add those together is you add the coefficients. Now, it just so happens that the coefficients here contain variables, right? 3x squared and negative 44x squared. And it just so happens that those variables have the same exponent. So I can combine 3x squared and negative 44x squared and get negative 41x squared times the square root of y. Okay, so a couple things had to happen on this last example. They had to be like radicals. And then once I saw that I could combine, once I saw that they were like radicals, then I added the coefficients. But because the coefficients contained variables themselves, I had to make sure that they were like terms. And they were, and so I was able to combine them and get negative 41x squared on the outside, and then times what they had in common for a radical with the radical they had in common, which was the square root of y. Okay, so lots to think about when you are combining like radicals. Until next time.